Welcome to the Viva Wars of Anatomy. Today's topic in the Viva Wars is a radius bone. Now the radius is a bone of the lateral side of the forearm. It is homologous with the tibia of a leg. It is an example of a typical long bone. So it's having upper end, soft and the lower end. First we will see the side determination of the radius. The upper end will contain the disc shaped head. Lower end is expanded from the side to side. The second thing, the sharpest border facing the medial, it is also called the intrusus border. Last thing, in the lower end, anterior surface is in the form of the thick prominent ridge, and the posterior surface will contain the grooves as well as one prominent dorsal tubercle of Lister. So the given bone is of a right side. Now we will see the feature and the attachment of the radius. It is having three parts, upper end, soft and the lower end. First we will see the upper end. Upper end is having three features. First, the rounded disc shaped head. Below the head there is a constricted part, that is neck, and the radial tuberosity. The disc shaped head is having the concave superior surface which will articulate with the capital of the humerus to form the part of the elbow joint. Elbow joint is a hinge variety of the synovial joint. Now the circumference of a radius is articular. It will articulate with the osteoligamentous ring. That is, the medial part will articulate with the radial notch of the ulna, and the remaining part will articulate with the annular ligament. And this will form the superior radio ulnar joint, which is a pivot variety of a synovial joint. Now next part, the neck is a constricted part below the head. Its medial part will provide attachment of a quadrate ligament. The third part, tuberosity, radial tuberosity. It is having the smooth anterior part and the rough posterior part. Smooth anterior part is related to the synovial bursa, and the rough posterior part provides insertion of the tendon of biceps brachii muscle. Now the second part of the radius, the soft. Soft is triangular in the shape, is having three border and the three surface. First we will see the border. It is having three borders, that is anterior border, posterior border and the medial border. Talking about the anterior border starts from the anterior part of the radial tuberosity above and ends at the styloid process below. Now in the upper part it is oblique, and in the lower part it is vertical and the crestalline. Now the upper oblique part will give origin to the radial head of flexor digitorum superficialis muscle, and the lower part provides attachment to the extensor retinaculum. The second border is a posterior border. Posterior border is a mirror image of an anterior border. Now it is only demarcated in its middle part. There is no attachment on the posterior border. The third is an intrusus or the medial border. The medial border is the sharpest of all the three border, and it will extend from the radial tuberosity above to the posterior margin of ulnar notch below. The lower 3/4 of this medial border will provide attachment of an intrusus border, and from the middle radio ulnar joint, which is syndesmosis type of a joint. Now talking about the surfaces. The first surface is the anterior surface, that is between the anterior border and the medial border. The anterior surface in its upper part gives origin to the flexor pollicis longus, and in its lower part gives origin to the pronator quadratus. The second surface is the lateral surface that lies between the anterior border and the posterior border. Lateral surface in its upper part gives insertion of a supinator muscle, in its middle 1/3 insertion of a pronator teres, and in its lower part just above the radial tuberosity, styloid process, it will provide insertion of brachioradialis. The last surface is the posterior surface that lies between the posterior border and the medial border. Now the posterior surface in its upper part gives origin to the abductor pollicis longus, and its lower part gives origin to the extensor pollicis brevis. Both these two muscles are the muscle of a thumb. Now we see the last part of the radius, that is lower end. Lower end is little bit expanded from the side to side. It is having five surfaces. We will see one by one. The first is the anterior surface. The anterior surface is in the form of the thick prominent rays and it will support the superficial radial artery. So the pulsation of the radial artery, you can palpate against the lower end and it's on its anterior border, anterior surface. The second surface is a posterior surface. The posterior surface is marked by the foregroove and it will present one tubercle that is known as a dorsal tubercle of Lister. The third surface, the medial surface. The medial surface will present one nose which is known as a ulnar nose, and this ulnar nose will articulate with the head of the ulna to form the inferior radio-ulnar joint, which is a pivot type of a synovial joint. Now the fourth border, a fourth surface, that is the lateral surface. The lateral surface is known as a styroid process and it directed somewhat downwards. The last surface, the fifth one, is an inferior surface. The inferior surface is articular. It is divided into the triangular lateral part and the quadrangular medial part. This triangular lateral part will articulate with the first carpal bone, that is scaphoid, and this quadrilateral medial part will articulate with the lunate to form the part of a wrist joint. Now we see the structure passing through the foregroove, which is situated on the posterior surface of a lower end. Now the first groove, that is, lies between the lower part of a sharp anterior border and the styloid process. This groove will pass the tendon of abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. The second groove, that is medial to the first groove, and it lies lateral to the dorsal tubercle of Lister. This will pass the tendon of extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis. The third groove, that is, lies lateral to the dorsal tubercle of Lister, the oblique groove, which lodges the tendon of extensor pollicis longus. The fourth groove, the last one, it will lodge the tendon of extensor digitorum, tendon of extensor indicis, and posterior introitus nerve and anterior introitus artery. Now the medial to this foregroove, the lies the gap or the groove between the lower end of a radius and the ulna. This groove lodges the tendon of extensor digiti minimi. Now we see the important applied anatomy of the radius. The lower end of the radius is common side of the fracture. When it will get fractured, the distal part will get disclosed backwards and the upwards. Then it is called a pulleys fracture. And sometimes this distal fragment will dislodge anteriorly and upwards. Then it is called the Smith's fracture.